And now, the final fantastic talk of the day, Mark Nelson.
All right, so when Mike asked me to give a talk, he said that ProcGen this year is not only about games, so I can talk about anything procedural. So I asked, can it be old and not games? And he said, sure. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about a few ideas from 1970s computer music. But first, to give a little, which I think might actually be useful for people working on games also, by the way. But first, to give a little context, I am actually secretly working on games, or maybe not so secretly. I work here at the MetaMakers Institute. We generate interactive, we work on generative interactive entertainment, which you could also call games, but also more broad things such as, you know, software toys, things that maybe aren't traditional games. And our general approach could be called parameterized spaces of games, and then various manual, automatic, semi-automatic ways of navigating those spaces of games for design, for automated design, for sort of end-user design of their own games. And so I'm really interested in parameterized game spaces. And now, these tend to be fairly complicated. So I'll briefly show you, let me switch over to QuickTime here. Full screen. All right. Some of what we've generated, just to give you an idea of the complexity of the space. And this is actually a really cut down, simpler version of the space. Some of you saw this yesterday. It's a game based on capturing five balls with this little target in the center. It's called No Second Chance. It will be out pretty soon. It's on test flight right now, if we can invite people to it. So this is an extremely simple one. They're just balls moving around. You have to follow them and capture five. Yes. And you can't, in this particular one, you can't let them touch each other if that happens, so you have to kind of keep them spaced. But to give you an idea of what else there is, let me go to the design interface. You can also generate random games here. What it does is it generates four games, auto-plays them, and picks ones that are neither too easy nor too hard for the auto-player. So that one is not a good game because the auto-player beat it really quickly. So here we get one that is supposedly in between. Now here there's two different kinds of balls. And some of the point of this game is figuring out what the extra strategy is. So here they can stick to each other, but if three hit each other, they explode. So you can grab like this. Oh. Yeah. Oh. In any case, you can kind of see I've actually never seen something like that one before. So this is a pretty big generative space, even though this is a really cut down version of the original 284 parameter space, which can generate games like Asteroids and completely different kinds of games. Well, these you can think of as all kind of levels in a similar space. But that was, of course, on purpose, right? Yes, I must have exited. In any case, this is it's a complex generative space, which at the moment we can sample. We can also manually, to show you an idea of some of the parameters, you can also manually change things. So there's this design interface, which we're revamping at the moment. But you can change sort of color type things. You can also change, let me go up. For example, what happens on collisions. That previous one had a critical cluster size of three, so when three got together, they exploded. You can change things like that. You can make balls stick, bounce off each other. In this case, A and B bounce, you could make them stick. Oh, there's only actually one kind of ball here, so that won't change anything. But we don't have a great idea of what this space looks like. We're just starting to map it out. So I'm going to talk a little bit about stuff in music which is much simpler, and people have made some attempt to map them out, and a few techniques that I think you can use on various things, even things like Twitter bots and little, you know, pixel art generators, various, any kind of generative thing. So that was mostly a sort of background there. What our ultimate goals here are. So for me personally, my route into generative computing came via computer music. I did sort of some projects in undergrad, and from there ended up kind of in interactive entertainment, other generative areas, and games. And I really like the interplay between sort of composers, technologists, algorithms, representations, hardware, software. Things can go in different directions. There's composers who invent software just because they want something to happen. There are technologists who then invent new technology that ends up causing new genres of music to appear, like 70s synth music is basically all produced by the advent of these synthesizers. And certain problems are better understood, in some cases because of a longer history of research, and in some cases just because they're easier. Like, there are certain things that are easy to mathematically analyze or to sort of visually analyze in music for a few reasons I'll get into. And some of these old techniques, I think, are still quite relevant and are actually much easier to use now. When you read these old papers, they'll talk about, we coded this on our VMS cluster, and then, you know, it ran for 12 hours, and it will run for like 12 seconds on your smartphone now. So many of these techniques are quite easy to use now. And so here's like the simplest possible generative music thing, which you wouldn't even call either music or possibly generative, but it nonetheless has a parameter. So the voltage-controlled oscillator is this oscillating device, a hardware module, where you have a sort of a low voltage control voltage that goes into it, and when you vary this voltage, it varies what frequency it oscillates out, and you get sound out. And you can see this as one parameter generative audio, which at least has a parameter, which here I'm calling the frequency. Here was the voltage is sort of what it literally is, but what it controls in the space, it's also a very easy mapping. So it controls the frequency of the oscillator, and what is perceived is the frequency of the oscillator changes. There's like nothing complex in this generative space. And to just start building up something to show you there, apologize for the classic Mac graphics here. This is Pure Data has been sort of updated over the years with more and more modules, but no one has ever overhauled the interface. There's a commercial version called Max MSP that has a much nicer interface, but I have not bought it. So, because you know this is good enough. Editing interface. Oh, yeah, is that wrong window? So we can say here we have an oscillator of some kind. Is that? That's actually really small. I wonder if I can zoom. No. This is actually much higher resolution. I think the TV is much higher resolution than my own computer is. But in any case, I'll draw this in here. This is really hard to control at this resolution. Oops. Do not want this there. This is sort of the perils of live coding on a new monitor. And I promise you at the end of this, it will not be a big revelation. You will get a tone that is exactly what you expect. Come on. No. Right. Oh, okay.
Are you on HDMI?
Yeah, I am. It worked earlier on a test, but well, if this doesn't work, it's not super critical. But no. And I don't think is there a way to give my audio back to my laptop?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Probably up here.
Well, sound preferences.
Control click the speaker.
Oh, just control click the. I don't have the speaker in my menu bar.
If you just open up the regular preferences.
Go back and then go to audio.
Second one, first, right?
Sound.
There should just be an option to do.
Internal speakers. Does that work now? Okay, yeah. There, now we have a very exciting sine wave. And you have this cool control parameter. All right. So you get the idea of what's happening here. Now you can do much more complicated things, of course. You can do two-parameter generative audio. For example, we have here two frequencies, a frequency one and a frequency two. And I'm not going to show you what this is because it will be extremely tedious, but you can imagine there will be two sine waves played at the same time. And this is still very easy to analyze because there's no weird interaction, except there is a slightly weird interaction. If the two are very close together, you get these beat frequencies. So somewhat strange stuff already starts happening, even in this extremely simple space. You can also slightly complexify this and with a third parameter that mixes these two things, which just makes one, you know, louder than the other. If you had many of them, you could put, you know, a volume on each of them, basically. And then you get additive synthesis, which mostly behaves as you would expect on small numbers of oscillators. But you can make one simple change here, invented by a computer musician in 1975, that makes it much more complicated. So take one oscillator and just feed it into the other one, because you already have these two. Like, it's two pieces of hardware that you already paid hundreds of dollars for, probably. And you can feed one into the other. And what that does is you have this oscillator whose frequency now oscillates according to this other oscillator. And that one I will show you. And at low levels of oscillation, it does kind of what you would expect. So we'll put a second one here. Just looking to see if there's a way to make this all bigger.
If you go to the PD menu, there's preferences, and you can change the font size.
That's a very...
There's two preferences.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. I don't see anything else here. I could change the resolution, because in my own monitor, resolution looked fine. Displays... It's still the same. Oh. Ah, that's better. Okay. Nice and low resolution.
Nice.
Okay. So.
Seen this software before? Is it free?
It's free, yeah. This is open. This is basically the open source version of MaxMSP, which is more professional in a sense. It's actually made by the same guy who made MaxMSP. There's some weird history where they commercialized his software, and then he made an open source clone of his own software because he somehow had a disagreement with the licensee, but with many, many fewer resources. Anyway, I think I'm not going to tediously go through and make this. Sorry about that. But I will show you some examples. But what ends up happening is you, at low frequency one, the frequency oscillates sort of as you would expect. At a higher frequency one, above about 20 hertz or so, it starts just coloring this frequency and you get sort of weird bell-like sounds. And it's very hard to control. Moving the two frequencies doesn't actually control the timbre in any interpretable way, really. And this dates back to some, the FM and frequency modulation is also like what's in FM radio. You can use this to transmit information, but computer musicians basically started using it to make different kinds of timbres, audios. But in any case, my point, what I'm going to go through here is how do we understand this space? So the first thing is just turn navigating this space into an aesthetic. So John Chowning, who invented FM synthesis, made a few pieces, which I'll play one of here with a spectrogram so you can have an idea of what it's doing. Is that not showing? Okay. It's a mix of extremely slowly varying the parameters and occasionally fading between two completely different parameter settings. In this case, sort of scary, spooky movie music, sort of. This whole piece is 15 minutes long, so I'm not going to play the whole thing, but but this was sort of like the first attempt to think of what is the FM synthesis space good for as a musical device. A much more recent thing is you can think of the dubstep genre as essentially like FM synthesis, exploring FM synthesis as a control space. And what they do is they take a specific part of it applied to bass notes and then put it through a few filters and then really overdrive it so it also has clipping and produces the kind of signature dubstep bass sound. And then they just move the parameters really fast to make these like wobbles. But that's basically the first attempt. It's just sort of, we have these weird parameters because that's the hardware we have. What can we do out of it? A second one could be to analyze the space mathematically. This is really enticing because we have these really simple mathematical functions like just sines and so on. And it's at least possible in this case. Two sinusoids aren't that complex of a function. And we also have this nice representation, which I'll get back to, we don't really have in games, in that audio itself is sort of in the time domain. You have different sound waves actually going out. But then steady state audio is perceived as a frequency spectrum. And we have a mathematical transform to give us the spectrum for any function we have. But even in this really simple, and actually in the first case, it does exactly what you expect. If you take the Fourier transform of this, you get back that all the energy is at the frequency you put in. It's exactly what you expect. And the same here, it's at the mix of these two. And in this one, it's at the like appropriately scaled mix of these two. Nothing is very surprising. But in this one, you get back not an impossibly complex function, but already one that is more complex than you might like. You have these kind of waves in frequency space, which are multiplied by this Bessel function, which is because there's no closed form solution for that, from negative infinity to infinity. You know, you can ignore the end parts of it. But in any case, it's already not that clear that this is a scalable approach. though nonetheless, there is some interesting analysis from all sorts of people, and much more since then, on kind of using signal processing as the way to understand generative spaces. Because we happen to have this transformation between frequency spaces, how we perceive these sequences of audio samples, and the actual thing we're generating, which is these things that go out on the wire. You could also map it. In this case, this is actually directly a function plot of the previous function. But you could generate this by sampling. You could just generate samples of all the different parameter settings without having an analytical. And this is a little easier to understand. So you have these waves in the frequency space. This is your choice of modulation index, which is one of the parameters. And the actual sound you hear is one of these slices through here. So as you move it, you're taking different slices. And these are actually not completely parallel to each other, which is part of the complexity. It's not 100% clear that this helps us understand better, but it does better than previously. So you could also make nowadays a real-time version of this where, you know, you drag it around and it shows you the current spectrum. And these are objective properties. So these are sound spectra, which is not what you put in. What you put in is these sinusoids modulating other sinusoids, but what you get out is what you perceive as this spectrum. So you've mapped it from one domain to a different objective domain. And you could then take further functions of this. Like you could characterize this as more widely spread energy, and this one is more narrowly spread, and you could plot that on a different function over time, which people have done. Moving to a completely different kind of thing. So this is a spectrogram of a clarinet, an actual instrument that people pick up and play, which actually has a very not super complex harmonic structure here. And this is already in the frequency domain. So, well, this is frequency here, and this is time as the clarinet note is played. So it varies a little bit over time. There's an onset and then decay. And this is a simplified clarinet spectrogram. If you say we need to use only about 15 buckets here and then approximate it with line segments. And this then is a generative space, basically. You can drag around these little lines and you get different spectrograms, some of which sound like clarinets also. Some are different notes on the clarinets. Some are different instruments like bassoons. And some are not clarinets or bassoons or any other instrument. Depends sort of how much you drag it around. Like, for example, here, these are lots of wind instrument spectrograms. These are all real ones that were recorded and then approximated this way. And so how do you arrange these? And this is a technique I like and haven't actually seen used that much. Actually, even in musics. One is to reparameterize the generative space according to subjective qualities. So not objective qualities of the space, but some kind of subjective way of arranging these things here. And so the method that was proposed is first in one direction, the visualization direction. Collect a corpus from the space of interest. This is a corpus. It's not a huge one, but we have bigger ones now. Analyze it into a simpler higher level representation, which is this representation here. And then present pairs to users to judge as similar and dissimilar. They just get an endless set of, like, does this sound similar to this? Like, these are both clarinets. This is a clarinet, and this is, like, static noise. Some are much... Typically, they don't ask people to rate the similarity and dissimilarity because that's harder to sort of come up with a consistent scale, but just say, are these similar or not? And you end up then implicitly with some kind of similarity space. And so then embed objects into a new space that arranges them by similarity. And this is one such thing from some nice 1975 plotting software. And then they've put, these are not real axes that, well, they're real axes in a sense, but these axes didn't come out with any information. They were labeled sort of subjectively by the author of the paper. The actual embedding here was done by multidimensional scaling, which is a general way of embedding similarity judgments in a space that kind of approximately preserves the similarity, so distance is correlated with similarity. And you can do it in two dimensions, three dimensions. You can, in principle, do it with many more dimensions, but usually two or three is what you want. These are labeled with like O's and OBO, but it could be any kind of thing. And then they've kind of gone through and attempted to say, what do these two axes mean? And so they've labeled one as more bright and the other as brighter. These are just saying that now we have these two new axes, can we, like, what do they represent? The algorithm doesn't actually try to come up with perceptually meaningful axes. It tries to come up with distance-preserving embeddings, which is not quite the same thing because you can kind of rotate in various directions as well. But it is one way of getting something that is more useful than, say, just doing some kind of direct distance between these two things by, say, subtracting differences. Because it's not that clear what really matters here. Like, is it the onset that matters a lot? Is it kind of the peak? Is it the low energy, the higher energy frequencies? Not all of them are equally perceptually important. And so this is kind of a theory-free way of doing it. You just ask people to rate a whole bunch of things, and then you get a new space. And then you can generate from the new space, possibly. So in the generative direction, you invert the mapping from this new space to the original objects. In their case, they did it by interpolation. This only works, of course, if you have a good interpolation method. In this particular case, they did some experiments and found that if you have kind of similar spectra, so in this case, all woodwinds, interpolating does produce spectra that sound kind of like they're in between the two. If you have completely dissimilar ones, you can end up with things that sound like you're just crossfading between one or the other. So halfway between like static noise and a clarinet just sounds like you have a clarinet at half volume and static noise at half volume. And that's what would happen, for example, if you're just using just general, a time domain audio as well. It just sounds like crossfading. And you could use nowadays techniques like the ones Adam discussed to actually come up with more complex interpolation than just, in this case, they just literally interpolated these line segments. You could also, there's various other techniques you could use. You could do a kind of generate and test thing, where if you have some way of determining if it is at this space, you just keep generating until you find something there. That could, in principle, take a long time. You may not actually find anything in that space. And there's two papers here, which I actually like quite a bit, which could be much simplified if they were not done in the 1970s, but nonetheless are pretty readable, I think. One is on multidimensional perceptual scaling of musical timbre, and the other is on timbre space as a musical control structure. And that one's been particularly influential, I think. And I kind of like to think of that whenever I look at other generative spaces. Like, would I transform this generative space into some other space that can be used as a control structure? Oh, you want to?
Share your slides later.
Yes, I'll share the slides as well. And so I have a few general takeaways from this. I mean, it's a pretty complex subject, and I started with kind of this really complex generative space we don't understand, and I've gone to some simpler generative spaces that people in the 70s somewhat understood. So that's like getting lower in ambition, but still not actually solving the problem. But in any case, I think there are a few takeaways we can get from this. So one is that in computer music, to transform between this time and frequency domain is really key and is useful for analysis, and partly because it is very mathematically well-defined. Like, there is this relationship, and you can go from one to the other. What it actually means kind of artistically is not always this clear, but it at least is a basis. In games, we have this idea of saying mechanics and dynamics, but we don't like have mathematical transforms between mechanics and dynamics, or even a good characterization of what dynamics are, other than like in general the gameplay as it, you know, unfolds. It's not like, you know, specifically the rhythm that is important. I mean, in some games the rhythm actually is important, but in other games it's different. Also, the initial parameters and axes. So basically there were two examples here. One is take, say, FM synthesis as your artistic style, like either this kind of avant-garde 70s music or dubstep or some other take on the FM synthesis space. The other is take this as just, you know, some raw input, we don't want this space, and come up with some other subjective perceptual space. And the other high-level pattern that I think of a lot, but it doesn't seem to be that, at least these terms aren't that widely used outside of music and some audio processing, is analysis resynthesis. So take some specific concrete object, analyze it into a higher level properties. In the case over here, the kind of approximated spectrograms, but you also have things like if you have, say, two very simple synthesizer sweeps going at the same time. You could have just the audio recording of it, or you could analyze it into, we have, you know, this synthesizer sweeping like this and this like this, and then you could drag and edit them around. So there's this very common concept of analyzing to a kind of editable, symbolic, higher-level domain and then resynthesizing from that. It actually started out as a compression technique that people noticed that voice was much simpler than the actual raw data, and they would analyze like the track of, say, the first, second, and third strongest harmonics in the voice and only transmit that, and then resynthesize at the other end, which is what vocoders are, and produce this like somewhat metallic sounding voice, but that is actually understandable and takes very little bandwidth to transmit, but it can also be used as a kind of control structure. And so those are my main takeaways from this, and kind of how you apply them to games is my current research, so it's sort of like an open question. But I thought these were sort of some interesting things to discuss, and I would like to see people experiment with some of these, like just simple things like apply multidimensional scaling to examples from various generative spaces I haven't really seen people do. So I'd be interested if it works or produces useful results. So that's kind of my general provocation there. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Bob. Do we have any questions?
Hi, Catherine.
Oh, I think it's a fantastic analogy. Well, maybe analogy. obviously, you know, from a computer music perspective, like there are often two major routes to come at the same result, and one is synthesis and the other is, generating the result, and the other is subtractive synthesis. And just, you know, what you talked about there sort of made me think, well, yeah, like, actually, you know, what would subtractive synthesis be for...
That's a good point, yeah, I didn't actually cover...
Like, you know, filter design,
okay, so to summarize the question, it was that I've made kind of an analogy here between generative music and, say, generation in other spaces like games, but what about other things I didn't mention at all in my analogy, like, say, filter design or subtractive synthesis, where you start with some kind of sound and produce various other kinds of sounds by subtracting components from it. Like, you start from white noise and then subtract a whole bunch of things to make a more harmonic sound. And that's a good question. I haven't actually thought through the analogy that far. I mean, like...
with a politician or something, you know, like. You can take someone's voice and make them sound like a donkey.
Yeah, actually, that's.
What's the equivalent in games? You know?
Yeah, that's something I actually was thinking of mentioning at the end here. That one thing you can do with analysis resynthesis that's fairly common is you analyze two different things and then you like swap the parameters. So you do like a voice analysis, but then you play it back by applying it to like a synth keyboard, which is a 70s trick that's used in a whole bunch of like pop music of the late 70s of singing keyboards. How you could do that in games, I would guess, because they're much more complex, you can't rely on these kinds of signal processing. techniques. You probably need, I mean, some of the building blocks of what Adam talked about earlier, you need some kind of extraction of style so then you can start swapping styles. It would be ideal to still have a high-level representation of style, I think, so I'm not that satisfied with like a completely end-to-end black box where you say, like, these are the style of things I want, and then I run, you know, neural networks on it, and I get the output. I kind of want to have these little control knobs, but those could be building blocks, I think, on getting the equivalent in, say, generative game spaces of what in generative music spaces you get through signal processing, which, unless we can invent some equivalent of signal processing that's like nice, clean, and mathematical for games, which... Yes, the VGDL, yeah. That's a good point. Any other questions? Rob?
Do you think you have any insights into where the low-hanging fruit are in games? So, you know, are there styles of game where you think this type of approach may be more fruitful?
That's a good point. A good question. The question is, do I have any insight into where the low-hanging fruit might be? Like, what styles of games or spaces of games would this be more fruitful? And my general feel is ones where somehow the space is a little more continuous. So, like, similar, there's some kind of change in parameters, which doesn't happen a lot in, say, very rule-driven games. Typically, a change in a rule can completely change the game. Or you need some other representation of the game of kind of like the play possibility space, which isn't the input rule space. We're working on physics-based games now, which have some of that property, but do also have this kind of chaotic thing where things can quickly sort of bounce out of control if you slightly change things. Within certain regimes, when you change things, you get what you expect. Like, everything is slightly faster, but then suddenly things are completely different. So I think that's something interesting to explore. I think maybe the first approach would just be more visualizations of spaces. I feel like I often don't at all understand what the layout of a space is. So I'd be interested in kind of trying to just sample and visualize some to get a better idea of what they look like.
I think we better call it there. So let's
All right, thanks a lot.